What's up, guys? This is Build Fix. We're back with another season for 2025, helping people build computers by choosing the right parts, especially if you're on a budget. There are new video cards coming out very soon from both NVIDIA and AMD, so a lot of people are planning to build a new system when those cards launch. This video is not about should you buy those new graphics cards. This video is for people who have already made that decision, what other parts should go with them. And now it's time for the January 2025 episode of Build Fix, proudly sponsored by PC Part Picker. Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware Store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise. Tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. So just to reiterate, I'm not telling anyone to go out and buy the RTX 50 series cards right out of the gate. You should wait until the reviews come out. We're gonna be testing them and comparing them and give you guys a better idea of what kind of value they're bringing to the table. And especially there's gonna be a lot more revealed, I think, in February when AMD's cards are probably going to be launching too. We haven't heard too many updates on those. But for Build Fix, I do a community post. That's right over here. Here is the results of the poll. It sounds like there's a lot more people interested in the 9070 and 9070 XT as compared to the NVIDIA 50 series offerings, although the 5090 is coming in second. And I agree, Sitter Dan, it's pretty clear where the interest of the community is, but we're gonna see how that plays out in terms of what people actually buy, because that tends to be a little bit different than what people say they're gonna buy online. So to simplify things today, I have two builds for you guys, and they're geared towards two different types of people who might be building a new system for the new graphics cards. The first is gonna be for people who are building on a budget, trying to spend the least amount of money possible to get the most performance possible, and they're recommending an AM5 system so you can have an upgrade path in the future and a window open for the X3D CPUs that AMD offers, but you can still get a lot of bang for your buck. The second build is for people who have a little bit more disposable income, who are just like, I want to build the fastest gaming PC possible, which is going to be the RTX 5090, paired with the 9800 X3D for now, and there, since we're assuming you're spending a little bit more money, we might have some more luxury upgrades that we add in there at the same time. So our first build comes from Yuchiha Sufi, who's upgrading from a Ryzen 5 3600 with a B350 motherboard, 16 gigs of RAM, and a GTX 1080 to a Ryzen 5 7600, got the Aorus B650AX motherboard, 32 gigs of 6000 speed CL36 memory. Still up in the air on the Radeon 9070 or an RTX 5070 Ti, maybe the 9070 XT is gonna be a viable option there as well, depending on the price and performance. This is the right outlook to have right now. You can be planning ahead, but you shouldn't be making any final decisions until we know what the actual performance is gonna be. Another reason I chose this build is he's running a 1440p 165Hz monitor, primarily for gaming, and that for me is a sweet spot for monitors right now. It's an upgrade in visual fidelity going from 1080 to 1440, and you want a high refresh rate, variable refresh rate monitor to do PC gaming in 2025. And for that, you're gonna want at least 144Hz refresh rate or 165 hertz as we're working with right now. Also a 650 watt power supply that might need an upgrade as well, which we will discuss. So I put together the build over on PC Part Picker. This is linked in the video description if you want to jump right to it. And I did leave the graphics card out for now, since that is a big question, is what the graphics card is going to be and how much it's going to cost. The least expensive next generation GPU that we have confirmation of pricing on is the RTX 5070. That's going to be $550. So we're looking at about an $800 base cost for most of these components. Then add the graphics card on top of that. So it's going to make this build cost around $1,350 to $1,400. Right from the top, we have our CPU, the Ryzen 5 7600X. I chose the X model and I paired it with the Thermalright Phantom Spirit 120 SE air cooler. So that's gonna bring the total here to $240-ish for the CPU and the CPU cooler. You could spend a few bucks less by going with the Ryzen 5 7600, the non-X. It runs a little bit slower, but it does come with a stock cooler in the box. However, current pricing has it costing $2 more, so for that reason, I would opt for the 7600X and then add an air cooler. You're gonna get better overall performance, and it's going to run quieter as well. There is a less expensive AM5 entry-level option. There's a 7400F that actually just launched in the past week. Seems very difficult to come by in the US. It's still a 6-core CPU though, so I would say keep an eye out for the 7400F as an alternative if you're sticking to a budget. There's a 7500F too, but that is also difficult to find here in the States. Next, we have a motherboard, and on AM5, you have B650 chipset motherboards that do everything you need a motherboard to do, and that typically cost in the $160 to $200 range, maybe low 200s. Gigabyte's Aorus Elite lineup has some good options in this range. It's a little bit on the more expensive side, but it is a very solid board. I would say just go for the V2 version. It's the same price as V1, and whenever there's a V2, it means they probably changed something to either fix it or make it better, so opt for V2. PCPartPicker has a compatibility filter, so if you're working on a build, it will only show you compatible parts unless you uncheck that. So that's helpful for choosing your memory, but I think you still want to opt for memory that's DDR5 6000 to maybe up to 6400. There is faster memory than that, but you want to make sure the ratio between your memory controller, your memory speed, and the Infinity Fabric are favorable, and for that, DDR5 6000 is the go-to. And then a 2x16GB kit is what I'd recommend for anyone who's building a new system. If you are building something a little bit higher end, consider a 2x32GB kit, or there are even 2x24GB kits out there that might sort of split the difference. So after we select those, we're just going to sort by price, and here's the least expensive memory that fits within that criteria. I would say look at cast latency next and try to choose a low value for cast latency. Lower is better. You can find some CL30 kits here, so that might be worth taking a look at. I actually ended up choosing the G-Skill Flare X5 set. For one, it's nice and low key and it blends in with most builds since it's a simple black design. But the second reason is that this is an AMD Expo kit, so it has Expo settings, which work kind of like Intel XMP, but they're more specifically geared towards the AM5 platform. So if you're buying new DDR5 memory for AM5, get an Expo kit. It's just going to make it a lot easier to set up and get it running at the proper speed. Beyond that, we have an SSD. A 2TB SSD can be easily found for less than $100. This one's $93. No, it's not the fastest PCIe Gen 4 SSD in the market, but it's a great price to gigabytes ratio. See, just like it says here, great bang for the buck, not the fastest drive on the market, but solid on speeds. We are skipping the video card, and then I have a solid middle of the road case, the Corsair 4000D, tried, true, and tested, and it's a popular option for $85. And finally, to answer that power supply question, I chose the MSI MAG A750BN. So if you're choosing a power supply, you should look at the GPU that you decide upon. That GPU will have a recommended power supply wattage alongside it. You want a power supply that's at least that many watts, if not 50 to 100 more, to give yourself a little bit of breathing room. So I'm gonna set the minimum wattage to 750 watts here, which should be okay for the mid and higher end graphics cards, although do wait for the actual reviews to come out so we can verify that recommended wattage amount. And then crucially down here, I'm going to the PCIe 12 plus 4-pin 12VH power connectors, and I'm gonna bring that up to 1. That's gonna show me any power supplies that have at least one 12VH power or 12V2x6 connector. And from there we can sort by price, find ourselves a brand that we're somewhat familiar with that makes reputable power supplies. MSI and Thermaltake, I think, fall into that category. And you know what? I'm gonna make a swap right here. The MSI MAG is only $78, but for just $2 more, but see, here's why we check. So this is a slightly older power supply from Thermaltake. It does have native 12VH power, but that's the slightly older plug that was a little bit notorious for melting when plugged into RTX 4090s. Now, if you're a reasonably confident PC builder, you can make sure you have your 12VH power plug seated and plugged in all the way, which I've done many times, and you shouldn't have any problems or concerns about melting issues. If that's you, then you can go for this power supply, which is probably discounted because it is slightly older from the last generation. And that means you're going to have a better efficiency rating at 80 plus gold, and this one is also fully modular. Or if you want the latest 12V2x6 version of that plug, then the MSI MAG is available for around $80. Trade-off here is this one is not modular, so all of the cables are hardwired, and it's 80 plus bronze rated instead of gold. So that is the core system, the AM5 build with an upgrade path that could easily be paired with any of these new graphics cards that are coming out. Base price is just shy of $800. Plus whatever graphics card you choose to buy. So an RX 9070 or 9070 XT, we're hoping those are around $450 or $500, but we're not quite sure yet, so we'll have to wait for some confirmed announcements. So there's my parts list with a few items that could definitely be swapped out if you want to shave off a few dollars here or there, or definitely you need to make some choices in terms of items like the power supply. In case you're wondering, NVIDIA has published specs for the 5080, the 5090, as well as the 5070 and 5070 Ti, and if we scroll all the way down to the bottom of that spec sheet, we can see for a 5080, it's recommended an 850 watt power supply. For the 5070 and 5070 Ti, you'll want minimum 650 watts or 750 watts respectively. And for the RTX 5090, all the way up to 1000 watts, which is somewhat understandable given its 575 watt total graphics power spec. Our next comment comes from Nightmare0021. Having recently upgraded from a PC with an 8700K to a 9800X3D, they transplanted the GPU, which is an RTX 3080 10GB, and we thankfully have a PC part picker list so we can look at the rest. They're saving around $1,100 for a GPU upgrade, which is that's probably going to be an RTX 5080 then. And then once again, we have a nice monitor setup, 1440x240Hz, but also potentially connecting to an LG 4K TV. I believe the CX series can do 120Hz with variable refresh rate, which is actually a really nice pairing for a gaming PC. And also might be dabbling in locally run AI, which is an NVIDIA card is a really good solution for. It's plug and play with a lot of these solutions that are currently available to run locally. So here's the parts list as provided. We have a 9800X3D, a Master Liquid 360 for $187, the MSI Mag X870 Tomahawk Wi-Fi for $280, a G-Scale Trident Z5 Neo RGB kit, which is DDR5-6000, that's the right speed, good timings. I would only say maybe you could go for 64 gigs with a build like this. A 2TB NVMe SSD, that's fine, although this one is expensive right now. There's the 3080 dropped in there, an Antec Flux Pro case, which is a nice case, a little bit more on the expensive side. We have a Superflower 1300W power supply. Superflower is a good PSU manufacturer. They're actually an OEM, and they make power supplies for a lot of other power supply manufacturers who actually just slap their logo on it. So double checking this one, it is 80 plus gold rated and actually Cybernetics Platinum rated, which is a really good rating. So this is a solid power supply. You don't need to swap this out, and it does have a 12VH power cable. That said, I am probably going to choose a different one for this build in terms of recommending stuff for other people to buy who are building a new system for a RTX 5080 or 5090. I also appreciate that the monitors are included here, and yeah, I really like this LG Ultra Gear monitor. Really good pixel density combined with a 240Hz refresh rate, and it's not like crazy expensive either. It's only around $350. So I'm gonna edit this list. I'm gonna remove and replace a few things. That doesn't mean they were bad decisions. I just think there might be things that might work a little bit better. For instance, $187 for a CPU cooler, I don't think is a good deal. This MSI motherboard is also a good solid motherboard, but for $280, I would either want an X670E chipset that's gonna give you more I/O, or an X870E chipset, which would also give you a lot more I/O. We might be able to find some better memory. We could probably find a better deal on an SSD. We're of course going to be swapping out the graphics card. I'm going to leave this here for now just as a placeholder since it's not affecting the price. And you know what? While a case is definitely very subjective and you should be looking at a wide range of cases to find one that meets your tastes aesthetically while also having like good build quality and airflow, the Antec Flux Pro is a good, more recent one from Antec, does have really good airflow, and for a build of this caliber, spending around $200 for a case isn't a bad idea. Okay, I did add the RTX 5080 as a custom part with a $1,000 price, so I hope you can find one for that much. As for a cooler, I'm gonna go with an all-in-one liquid cooler since that's what you had originally chosen, and you can find plenty of perfectly good 360mm AIOs for around $100. You don't need to spend $150, $200+. I mean, unless you really want an LED or an LCD screen on yours, but that's just an aesthetic upgrade. And since you had originally chosen a Cooler Master, let's stick with that. They're a reputable company. They've been making AIOs for quite some time. And this one's only $100. Again, for the record, you could easily go with an air cooler here. The Thermalright Phantom Spirit will cool a 9800X3D without any problems. So consider saving yourself $60 or $70 if you don't need the AIO. For our motherboard, I'm just going to look at X670, X670E, and X870E chipset motherboards because X870 is a bit cut down. X870 is fine if you're looking more towards the budget range, say $200-ish or so. But we're building high-end and there's really no difference in the chipsets and everything. So for example, for less than $200, we have an MSI X670E Gaming Plus Wi-Fi. This is going to give you way more connectivity than an X870 chipset motherboard, and as long as it has a USB BIOS flashback feature, you just need to update the BIOS and then it works just fine with a 9800X3D. We also have some somewhat more reasonably priced X870E motherboards like the Gigabyte X870E Aorus Elite Wi-Fi 7. This one's coming in for $320 over on Amazon. It does have Wi-Fi 7, so faster wireless, and one of the nice things about the X870 and X870E chipsets is it does have USB 4. It's a tough choice between those two. I'm gonna go with the Gigabyte option. It is a little bit more expensive, but we are building a high-end system here that's gonna pair with like a 5080 or 5090. Next, we're gonna choose memory. Still looking for DDR5, 6000 or a little bit faster, and a 64 gig kit this time around, which is gonna cost a bit more money, but has a lot of advantages, especially if you're gonna do any productivity work with your system. And I thought, let's look for some tighter timings too, so I tightened up that cast latency rating. Lots of silicon power options down in this range. So down here we can see you have some silicon power memory options for in the $140 to $160 range. You can even add something like RGB to that. I'm going to spend just a few more bucks and opt for a G-Scale kit. And you know, one of those would be totally fine if you're trying to stick to a budget. I've never had any problems with silicon power. But again, since we're going for something slightly nicer with this one, I'm gonna upgrade to a G-Scale DDR5 kit. I'm gonna upgrade to a G-Scale kit, and let's go with the Z5 Neo RGB. And you know what's funny, I just checked the original build, and I basically chose the same kit. I just went with the 64 gig capacity instead of 32 gigs, and it's not quite double the price. Next we need an SSD, so I've chosen that, as well as the M.2 2280 form factor, and I'm sorting by price per gigabyte. That's gonna show us the least expensive drives in terms of price per gigabyte. It's also gonna show you the 4 terabyte drives that pop up here and there. Those are very convenient to have, though they're typically gonna start closer to $200 versus 2 terabyte drives that you can find for less than $100. So there are plenty of 2 terabyte options in this range. 4 terabyte drives are starting out at about $190. And I think from this list, the one that stands out to me a little bit is gonna be our Team Group MP44Q. So this is a higher end PCI Express Gen 4 drive, 4 terabyte capacity, and it's got speeds up to 7,400 megabytes per second. So that actually is making use of that Gen 4 bandwidth. And it's only about $10 or $12 more than the cheapest 4 terabyte drive. And then lastly, we have a power supply. We've already established for a 5080, we're gonna want at least an 850 watt unit. But again, here's where you might consider an upgrade path or just looking at other options that are on the market. I think it's a reasonable decision to spend an extra $10, $20, or $30 on a power supply to give yourself more flexibility for a graphics card upgrade in the future, because you can of course remove a power supply and replace it in a system, but that is basically like gutting the entire system. Having a power supply in place that you can just swap a GPU out, it makes for a much easier upgrade. So in that case, if you do have your sights set eventually on something like an RTX 5090, it might be worth your while to go for a 1000 watt unit out of the gate. And again, just looking at our base criteria here of 850 watts or more and having one of those 12VH power or 12V2x6 connectors, we can see 850 watts units are starting around $90 to $100. And then we see some 1000 watt units popping up at around the $120 price range. So you're probably looking at more like $120 to $150 for one of those. Ooh, be quiet. Oh, is that 5.1? This is 12V2x6. Wait, 300 watts though. All right, I've verified this. Okay. I always find it interesting doing these videos because I discover new products that I have to sort of double check on and verify. But if you're going for a 1000 watt power supply, you want a reputable manufacturer. This Be Quiet Pure Power 12 seems to be like a really solid option right now. I'm gonna add it. It is not fully modular, so that's something you might wanna spend a few more bucks on if you want a fully modular unit. However, it's 1000 watts, it's $130. And I had to go over to Newegg to double check, but yes, we have a PCIe 5.1, so that's a 12V2x6 connector that can deliver up to 600 watts of power, which is gonna be just fine for an RTX 5090. And so, coming back to our overall list, here are the parts that I would opt for if you want to build like the best, fastest gaming PC possible right now without overspending in order to accommodate one of the newest video cards from Nvidia, if you've got the money. Now, I specifically want to point out that the Ryzen 7 9800X 3D has been difficult to find because it's pretty clearly the best choice for a gaming PC right now. However, they have been coming into stock at $480, so definitely do not spend an extra $100 plus on Amazon scalper pricing. That's not a good idea. Hold out and wait for an MSRP chip, and then you can pair it with a lot of these components. As hopefully I mentioned as I was going through these parts, there are parts you could swap in here and there to save yourself even more money on this build. But if you're going for something high end, this is going to come in at less than $3,000 with the 5080, which means you could easily swap it to a 5090. And yes, the 5090 would be half the price of this system, so don't take me out of context here, but $4,000 for that kind of build is somewhat reasonable. At least it's going to be less than, like, look for pre-builts with 5090s and see what they're charging you and compare that to the specs that we've lined up right here. And I'm pretty sure you're going to get a better bet choosing your own parts to accommodate your needs, buying them individually, and then assembling them yourself, which is a lot of fun. I'm going to be doing that pretty soon as well. But for now, I got to get back to some benchmarking, I think. Thank you guys so much for watching this video, and a huge thank you to PC Part Picker for sponsoring this series. Links to the PC Part Picker lists, as well as individual parts, are down in the video's description. Also, you can find a link to my store down there at paulshardware.net, where you can get yourself some high-quality merchandise, like this premium hoodie that has been keeping me warm for most of the winter so far. Thanks again for watching this video, you guys, and we'll see you all in the next one.